More and more people are increasingly aware that we're a much more mysterious species than we give ourselves credit for, and that there are many more mysteries and secrets in our past. And this intuitive sense that people have is driving them to re-examine the past of the human race, whether or not the historians and the scientists want to do it. The people themselves are leading the way in this quest for the truth about our own past.
This whole area right here has some of the best stonework in Cusco, and really fine, megalithic, jigsaw pattern. And we'll see more of this on an even larger scale tomorrow when we go to Sacsayhuaman, the giant fortress above Cusco.
This is the most sacred place in all of the Inca world. The absolute center belly button, the core. And it's most probable that this building existed thousands of years before the Inca ever existed. When they arrived in Cusco, this building was here. So anybody with any intelligence, they simply adopted it. And you can see the exactness of the construction. This again is an example where there is no mortar whatsoever. And the stone fits so tightly together that it's possible on a spiritual level or whatever that the whole place vibrated as if it was one stone. For some reason they decided to do this. Either it's a repair or they wanted to show off how good they were. Or it's even possible that, again, because they wanted the building to resonate as a single unit, nothing could be missing. So that little tiny piece was put in there with an exact fit. But this goes straight through 3 feet to the other side with this perfect joinery. And so this is what the archaeologists, again, refused to accept.
Well, that's the thing. You look at one of these, you know, one of these perfect seams going straight, at least straight through to the end here. Like that would take hours and days to do one of these. And the whole damn building is down that way.
Do you think they cut these to the size at the quarry site or when they got them here?
Well, the thing is, the andesite, it's composed of andesite on some walls, but that outer wall that we'll see that has a curve is basalt. The basalt came from 60 kilometers away. So when they say this was the Inca's first construction project, there is no example anywhere in the, you know, anywhere in the vicinity, including where they came from, that looks like this. So there's more mounting evidence that the Inca found the building and simply moved, you know, this building and four or five others in Cusco were the remains of an ancient civilization that disappeared, and the Inca adopted it. They couldn't have done it with Inca tools. They couldn't have done it, you know, people say lasers. Lasers can't cut stone. They may have had an ultrasonic sound tool that was able to cut, cut straight through. But this is not an Inca building. This is an example of the possibility of the descendants of an Atlantean culture that came and built this. Mm. You know, this is 12,000 years old. It's not 500 years old. But the people you want to ask is, you don't want to ask an archaeologist, you want to ask a stonemason.
Yeah.
And say, how would you do this? Yeah. And any of the ones that I've asked, they just sort of go, no.
Yeah.
We can't do that, really. Or we could, but we could do like a little section, but it would take, you know, quite a while. Diamond saws can cut this kind of stuff, but even a diamond saw is going to have a certain bend to it. So as it's cutting through stone, it's not cutting a perfectly straight line. It, because of the material, it's forced usually to do, you know, I'm exaggerating, but slightly within millimeters this way and that way as it's going through it. Mm. So then when you try to fit the two together, you can't because you have all that gap. If there's like I was saying before, if there's an eighth of an inch difference between this surface and that surface, they don't fit together. You have to be able to have them perfect because this goes straight through to the other side. So possibly the most important stone in this entire building is this one right here. This is a perfectly machined drill hole, core drill hole. Because we can see the marks, you know, I've taken a felt or a flashlight and shone it this way through it. And you can see the marks that the tool left as it was traveling through the stone. It goes 2 feet this way, but we don't know where the other piece is. But this is a perfect circle, and that's a core. That is an ancient core drill, just like supposedly in Egypt, that was able to plow through this material, which is andesite, you know, which is between 6 and 7 out of 10 on the Mohs scale. And there are four lines that go straight through it. So according to what Chris Dunn's theory, being a man who's worked in a machine shop for 40 years, is that it's the drills didn't rotate. It's a vibrational tool, very high vibration. And what it does is it pushes through, and because it's going like that, that's how it moves. It's almost like it has cutting teeth, diamond or whatever, very fine like that, but it's moving like that at a super high vibration. And in this case, what happens is that four little bits of material were caught in the teeth as it's traveling. And so they cause the score line as it goes through. So don't think in conventional terms of a drill moving this way. It's moving super fast this way, which is probably more efficient because it's probably random orbital too, so it goes and just plows right through it. You know, those who wish to, and I think you have to when you get into Egyptian or pre-Inca studies, is you have to get into a more esoteric area and think about energies. And so one theory is that the reason for these clamps is that they tried to get the stones as close fitting as possible, but they could never be perfect. So by having a clamp connecting one to the next, energy travels from one through it, just like a series of batteries. Not in terms of power, but in terms of very subtle energy. Because if you can make the interior of a building slightly different energetically, then you automatically go into a meditative state. And that's what churches or temples are for. You go from the outside world to a world where you communicate with whatever it is you think, you know, made you. So what you can see here, if you follow, you can see the fact that that this line is shining. The joinery has a glow to it, as if they were, you know, they were attempting to harden the surface for, you know, for some reason.
While it's true that many attempts have been made to explain how primitive cultures could have moved, placed, and aligned such giant blocks of stone with a skill and precision which we would be at pains to duplicate today, the fact is that nobody knows for sure how it was done. Today, astonishing new evidence is emerging to show that the ancient builders were far more sophisticated than has previously been supposed. In fact, there are some, including, for example, many top government defense scientists, who have employed advanced mathematics and engineering tools to demonstrate achievements in ancient technology which our own science has yet to equal.
I don't have a clue what that is. That's one of the things that always just intrigues me. It almost looks like it was a piece of machinery.
Oftentimes, archaeologists find information and evidence that shows that they're wrong, particularly that civilizations were more advanced in ancient times.
And how the hell did they do this? That stone is 120 tons. Factually, according to Thor Heyerdahl, when he did his work on Easter Island, it would take 15 men to push a one stone block horizontally.
Wow.
So at 120 tons, the quarry's supposedly at least 10 miles away somewhere. How could anybody have done this? Again, with precision joinery. And what the, again, you know, it would be nice if the archaeologists would consult engineers and stonemasons and people with a certain level of expertise in different fields and say, how was this done? But what they actually believe is that, for example, this stone was put into place. And then in order to get this one into place, it was rough, and so they took it, and then they would shape it, fit it, pull it back. Shape it, fit it, pull it back. And on the next level, the same thing. The men would have to come and lift, approximate the stone, shape it, lift it into place, go, no, we have to take that off. Pull the stone down, shape it, put it back, you know, come on. This is 40 tons. The simple fact is nobody knows who made this. But again, in the, you know, in the Inca tool chest, they had two tools. They had bronze chisels, which would bend as soon as they hit the stone once. And they had stone hammers, sometimes meteorite, sometimes obsidian, or basalt. And this marking is what the archaeologists say is the finish. But since these big, huge ones that at one time did perfectly interlock, these have moved apart, possibly as the result of an earthquake, but since there's no tool marks on this, they can't say it's Inca.
I mean, it's also strange, and even mainstream archaeologists have trouble trying to explain all this because it's just, the cells are just so big, so heavy. And in fact, you know, you could arguably say that even if you hired the most modern construction company today in Cusco and told them, oh, we want you to make a wall just like this. And yeah, those engineers at that construction company, and they have power tools, cranes and stuff like that, they would still say, no, we can't do that. But if you take a normal compass and you bring it up onto this seat, it starts to turn and swivel. There's some magnetic anomaly right here. And they call this the seat of the Inca.
Certain amount of documentation. The Egyptians themselves, for example, talk about their, they say in their texts quite openly that that their own civilization extends many, many thousands of years further back than the time of the pharaohs. This is simply discounted by archaeologists and Egyptologists. But when you look at the figures that the Egyptians give, which unfortunately are not in very close agreement with each other, but they're talking in the neighborhood of 25, 35, 40,000 years, and oddly enough, the Vedic texts also talk about origins of civilization, and they're also giving a period of around 40,000 years.
But it's like they were worshiping this thing, or making an altar to this rock for some reason.
Yeah. Yeah. On an esoteric level, this again may be maybe why the integration of these stones was important, because the vibratory nature of the stone itself might have been part of the rituals that were involved here. Mm-hmm. Well, most of the stories say that the Inca used that as, that was the place where they did mummification because it's a constant temperature, like it's like a natural refrigerator. And because of the dryness, usual dryness of the air here and the air flow, that's where once they remove the organs, then the body would, you know, would desiccate. But original function, God knows, because it's a lot older.
The condor at Pisac looms 2,000 feet high above the valley floor, a mile across. At its base is one of the largest necropolises in Peru. At its peak is one of the Inca's most sacred temples. Its terraces are precipitously steep and impractical. It seems an absurd place for agriculture, given the availability of flat land in the valley bottom.
The Condor was another of the black cloud constellations in the Milky Way. And in this one, the neck and the beak parts are made of agricultural terracing. The whole right side of the mountain is the right wing, and coming towards us, the left wing. And the Condor is lifting off, and under its wings are pre-Columbian grave sites. And it's because the Condor eats only carrion. It's associated with death. And its function here is as a mythical image carrying the souls of the dead to the hereafter. The terraces on the back and on the neck as well are placed in a pretty precarious spot. They're useful and they're still farmed today, but you can also look at any other part of the mountain and say, why didn't they put terraces there? Terraces is what they were primarily interested in. You can see that they're using the terraces as a sculptural element.
to me, they're saying that, well, history is a straight line graph where we have caveman down here at the bottom, and then up at the top of the graph there's modern man. I maintain, and others do of course as well, that history is this roller coaster of ups and downs, and these peaks and valleys in this roller coaster have been going on for tens of thousands of years, hundreds of thousands of years, and not just the last few thousand years.
I think it was partially carved. The question is how, because you would need a ladder almost 1,000 feet tall to reach the bottom of his beard. And it's as if they wanted to keep the growth area, you know, on his chin like that.
According to many of the ancient sources, including legends, there is evidence that levitation and sonic sound technology has been used in levitating stones.
4.5. Okay, so that's 20 tons.
20 tons.
That's the quarry right up there. You see where the scree field is? That's where these came from. And the trail is only about as wide as a horse can eat, like one horse can travel. So they had to zigzag them down this trail somehow, get them across the river, and then get them up this way. These little narrow things here, theoretically, during an earthquake, they ride up and down. So they're the ones that absorb the shock, take the shock and make sure that the whole thing doesn't, that they don't move out of position. And sunrise comes straight up, solstice sunrise comes straight up across this way, right across the face of it. And these different angles that are here, as the sun's shifting, a whole pattern, it's like a TV, a whole pattern develops. And as the sun's tracking, the shadows start moving. So it's like it's telling you something, it's trying to tell you a story. Yeah. That's where on the solstice the sun comes up here. It's winter solstice comes up right up here and it shines there first. And supposedly that is where underneath that field is where the initiation of the Inca would take place.
Well, the first time that I climbed to the vantage point where I can resolve the image of the pyramid was on a June solstice. And all I could think of was who built this and what an amazing thing it is to build an invisible pyramid. The first thing that they did was to go to their Indian friends here in the valley and said, well, what's the deal with this pyramid? And everybody said, what pyramid? Well, it's about 1,000 feet on a side, which makes it larger than the base of the Great Pyramid in Egypt.
25 million cubic feet.
1.5 million tons of rock and soil, all moved by hand, and all to make a pyramid which from almost every angle you look at it is invisible. It's remained unknown because you can only see it well if you make the 2-hour climb up the mountain on the other side of the river to Lukerts, from where, Fernando thinks, the construction of the pyramid was directed. Only from here does the illusion work properly, and its full layout, including the terraced sunken fields called windows, become clear.
As the sun comes up, it first enters into the window, and then as the beam of light spreads, it starts to move up and points like an arrow up the road. And then the next thing that happens is that it enters the ruins of Ollantaytambo above, and the ruins right there in Ollantaytambo are an enormous effigy of the Yama. But in case you thought your imagination was running away with you, the Incas wanted you to know that this was for real, because the only star in the Black Cloud constellation is called the Eye of the Yama, and that's what lights up first here on the June solstice.
And it's not just the June solstice. On the December solstice, the rising sun grazes the other face, 1 meter higher or lower, and this wouldn't happen. And on the equinoxes, it strikes the edge. So all the solar alignments are contained in this one monument.
The mainstream establishment finds it difficult to look at the world in a different way than they have. And this is very much the story of ancient technology and particularly advanced ancient civilizations. It's a way of looking at the past differently than our high school teachers or TV has taught us how to do.
Thank you.
almost any oral tradition of Native people. It's always cyclical. You know, these people, the so-and-sos, who are now mythical, you know, then they did something stupid, or the earth decided to do something to them, and then boom, down you go, all the information's lost. You know, the Dark Ages in Europe was the same thing. The church decided to destroy the records of anyone who existed before, out of control. You know, no, we're it. This book, you know, history starts with, you know, with 6,000 years ago. But we're, you know, it's just becoming more and more nonsensical. How can human species have been around for at least 250,000 years, and just in the last six, all of a sudden, these explosive evolutions of development happen? It's stupid.
Yeah.
You know, and the more that the general public catches on, the more we'll know who the hell we are, and the less we'll have these, you know, these pricks in authority trying to tell us who we are.